If you break down the word scleroderma, it means hardened and skin. This makes perfect sense because it's an autoimmune condition in which lots of collagen deposition leads to thickened skin. However, the way the disease is classified can be really confusing. When scleroderma is purely limited to the skin, it's known as morphea. On the other hand, the systemic form is known as systemic sclerosis, which causes fibrosis in a range of organs. This has two variants, a limited disease, which is previously known as CREST syndrome, and a diffuse form, which is more severe and only accounts for about 30% of cases. The exact pathogenesis of scleroderma is unknown, but we think it's something to do with vascular damage. This causes the release of inflammatory mediators, which results in vasoconstriction. In some people with this disease, it triggers an immune response which eventually increases fibroblast activation, causing excessive collagen production. Some key risk factors include a family history of scleroderma, age between 40 and 50, female sex with a 4-to-1 female to male ratio, and exposure to environmental substances like silica dust. Let's focus on the clinical features of systemic sclerosis. Its limited version, CREST syndrome, classically presents with crest features. C for calcinosis cutis. This is a skin finding caused by the deposition of calcium. It presents as a small, localized hard mass on fingers, forearms, and other pressure points. R for Raynaud's phenomenon. This is an episodic reduction in blood supply to the fingers or toes, usually triggered by the cold. Typically, one or more fingers will turn white and numb. Attacks can be painful and often last from minutes to hours. E is for esophageal dysmotility. This disease causes smooth muscle atrophy and fibrosis. This results in both dysphagia, or difficulty swallowing, and gastroesophageal reflux. S is for sclerodactyly. This is a tightening of the skin over the fingers, which can give them a spindle-like appearance. Finally, T is for telangiectasia. These are small dilated intradermal blood vessels and are also known as spider veins. In both limited and diffuse systemic sclerosis, you should consider autoantibody testing. A positive antinuclear antibody, or ANA, can be found in 90% of cases. However, the anti-centromere antibody, or ACA, is more specifically associated with the limited disease. Diffuse systemic sclerosis is a more rapidly progressing disease and has more severe systemic involvement in addition to these features. Skin involvement in the diffuse disease can cause changes proximally, including the trunk, while the limited scleroderma version is restricted to sites distal to the elbow or knee. Pulmonary involvement, including interstitial lung disease, is more likely to be clinically significant in the diffuse disease. Together with pulmonary hypertension, pulmonary disease is the commonest cause of death in patients with systemic sclerosis. Severe and life-threatening renal involvement, called scleroderma renal crisis, develops in approximately 10% of patients and almost invariably occurs in the early stages of the disease. This medical emergency develops over a few days and is characterized by an abrupt onset of malignant hypertension and renal failure. Intestinal involvement may lead to malabsorption due to bacterial overgrowth and intermittent bloating, pain, or constipation. Dilated bowel due to autonomic neuropathy may cause pseudo-obstruction with nausea and vomiting. Autoantibody testing, including ANA, should also be done. However, the diffuse disease is associated with anti-SCL70 antibodies, which are also known as anti-topoisomerase 1. The management of this condition aims to minimize the functional impairment it causes. Unfortunately, we currently have no treatments available that reverse the actual underlying fibrotic changes, although this might be changing. For skin fibrosis, general hand, foot, and nail care are important in all stages of the disease. Regular application of emollients and avoidance of soap can be useful. Pruritus might be helped by oral antihistamines. Also, maintaining range of motion in the hands is especially important. In the severe disease, immunomodulatory drugs, including oral cyclophosphamide, can help reduce the extent of skin involvement. Lung involvement requires ongoing monitoring with pulmonary function tests, echocardiograms, and high-resolution CT chests. Interstitial lung disease might also benefit from immunomodulatory therapy. Targeted therapy for pulmonary arterial hypertension might include drugs like endothelin receptor antagonists. Scleroderma renal crisis can be very severe. Any hypertension needs to be treated aggressively with ACE inhibitors, even if renal impairment is present. In any patient with the disease, an increase in blood pressure of 30 millimeters of mercury or more above baseline should prompt an urgent referral to a specialist. The use of corticosteroids is a risk factor for scleroderma renal crisis, and you should avoid high doses of prednisolone greater than 15 milligrams daily. For esophageal dysmotility, lifestyle measures to reduce gourd symptoms include elevating the head of the bed, reducing caffeine intake, and avoiding spicy foods. The mainstay of pharmacological therapy is the use of proton pump inhibitors. Surgical interventions for severe cases like endoscopic dilation might be required for esophageal strictures. For the treatment of Raynaud phenomenon, lifestyle interventions including smoking cessation, avoiding cold exposure, and using gloves is often sufficient to control symptoms. While drugs like beta blockers should be avoided as they can worsen symptoms, dihydropyrimidine calcium channel blockers like amlodipine can be used to reduce vasospasm. To remember key facts, I use this mnemonic. Diffuse systemic sclerosis is about 70 times worse for you and is your top priority. So you need to think about CPR. This should help you remember that the diffuse variant is associated with anti-SCL70, which is also known as the anti-TOP O-isomerase antibody. You need to keep in mind, corticosteroids can trigger one of the main causes of death, a scleroderma renal crisis. Finally, P stands for pulmonary involvement because pulmonary arterial hypertension and interstitial lung disease make it the commonest cause of death in patients with diffuse systemic sclerosis. On the other hand, limited systemic sclerosis is associated with ACA, the autoantibody with the shorter and limited name, and has CREST features, including C for calcinosis cutis, R for Raynaud phenomenon, E for esophageal dysmotility, S for sclerodactyly, and T for telangiectasias. Please don't forget to hit the notification button. It really helps me grow the channel and produce more videos. Thanks.